This is the Central Business Architecture Committee meeting. We will be reviewing possible design guideline changes, starting from guideline 11 and forward. First, open to any public comment, but there appears to be no public. So we'll move right on to guideline 11.
Which coincides on dean buildings.
Right.
34 in the old book.
34?
Page 34.
On my computer, it says 40. Well, just because of the D.
So cornices on theme buildings. The historic cornices of corbelled brick, pressed metal, or wood should be preserved when present. That seems a reasonable guideline. Decorative cornices at least 2 feet high should be built on the street facade of new theme buildings and should reflect the detailed pendant-like patterns or other rich patterning apparent in adjacent and nearby historic buildings. Such cornices should be corbelled or otherwise in horizontal relief to the street. The only comment I had about that is the requirement for it to be at least 2 feet high. I'd almost rather it say something about in proportion to the overall facade, or to add that as part of the comment.
I think you want to preclude just a coping or something like that.
Right.
Such as you have in the bad example to the right.
Yes. I guess 2 feet may not be sufficient either, and I would want to have a little more teeth about it being proportional, because I think probably most of the theme buildings in downtown Northampton on the 4 and 5 stories are more than 2 feet high.
So you like to say 2 feet high or in proportion to adjoining buildings or?
Adjoining buildings or in proportion to the building itself.
Yeah.
The example, which example is in, you notice that my book and what's here are sometimes different examples.
Do you want to look at another one, or do you want me to go to street view so you can look down the street?
Sure.
Oops. Come on.
Can you use the Google Earth? Is there a way you get, I notice it has like all the lot lines.
Uh-huh.
Is that an array that anyone can get?
From our webpage, we've linked our geographic information database for.
And that's publicly accessible, I think.
Yeah. I don't know what's wrong with.
Is the 3D buildings checked up over there in the lower left corner?
No, I've taken those off, but I was trying to get to street view, but I can do 3D.
Example, the bus station over there outside.
Uh-huh.
That's considerably taller than a 2 foot corner, 2 foot cornice.
Mm-hmm.
So. Top street, well, maybe now that it's up. Yeesh. Not coming up.
All right, it says at least, so that's a bit of a.
Now we're in the building.
That's so cool. Fine.
Back to the discussion.
Yeah.
We are inside.
I'm thinking you get the sunny side of the street.
Yeah, okay. You can see a little bit of the 3D. I just see that. My street view is not working. But that is weird.
Technical difficulties.
Look how.
The roof.
Yeah.
Yeah.
they've been extruded way up over. So I don't know if that helps at all to see that. I can't really zoom in.
Well, I'm sure we can word this to adjust it.
It's also kind of tricky to give a dimension when it's difficult to tell exactly when the cornice starts.
Right.
And what's part of the entablature and what's part of the cornice. I'm just looking out here, that's what, Peter Pan building?
Right.
You know, it's perfect, that's exactly what we want, but
right.
How do you describe that? Because the cornice is really up at the top, and then you've got the entire entablature up in that above the line there. I would say something like 2 feet or at minimum 2 feet.
Well, it says at least 2 feet, so that I think implies minimum.
Yeah.
And then we just want to add, and it should be in relation, in proportion to adjoining buildings and to the scale of the building itself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And historically, these came out of pattern books. The brick companies would hand out just patterns by the yard, corners by the yard.
So, how did you want to phrase that? Can you repeat that?
It should be at least 2 feet high and in proportion to adjoining buildings and to
the building
and
itself.
In the proportion of the building itself. That's 2 proportions there. Your English is probably a little better than mine. Proportion to the joint.
Can I hear proportion to? Except they can't spell.
I would say adjacent, because adjoining means they're
okay.
Plunked next to each other.
Yeah,
and adjacent would be nearby.
Okay.
And the building itself. And then I'd say period, because this is a really long sentence.
Yeah, I was noticing it. It says adjacent also later in that sentence. So.
Shall be at least 2 feet high in proportion to adjacent. Cornices shall be built on the street facade of new theme buildings. To start the next sentence.
Yeah.
What you added kind of just repeat what it says later, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Well, is that patterning versus proportion?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. I wasn't thinking about that.
Yeah. Any other comments on that one? Guideline number 12, facade detailing. Historic facade details should be preserved when present. Such details may include coins, brackets, decorative brickwork, incised ornament, carved columns, etc. Have any comments? Waiting for a historian to come in.
Our architectural historian down,
yes,
down
yeah.
the table there.
You
okay with that first sentence?
Hmm? Yeah, I think first one.
Yeah.
New construction should respond to the small-scale detailing of surrounding historic buildings by displaying stylistically consistent, compatible detailing on street facades. Again, I think that that's fine.
I don't think it's anything we've ever really enforced or actually pulled at that point.
I did bring that up on the Valley CDC building.
The lumberyard building, yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
The lumberyard building.
Yeah, yeah, right, yeah.
So does that, is surrounding too broad of a term? Or maybe it will make a difference if we talk about, sort of after wrapping this up, if we talk about sub-districts or different portions of downtown,
mm-hmm.
and so what that historic means, or surrounding means, you know, if you're in one of those areas versus Main Street, say.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think this would, so putting that aside is, and sort of thinking about that lumberyard project, how far, or does it, is surrounding too general of a term?
I guess to me the surrounding implies the central business district.
As a whole?
As a whole.
Okay.
I know that the lumberyard project, because it didn't have many buildings on either side of it to reflect on, there was not much to work off of, but it did have a building across the street that did have similar detailing to what we wanted in this district. Unless we're saying that the further away you move from the Main Street area, the more flexible we are in terms of the detailing of the buildings.
That would be
Is
our intention, wouldn't it?
Well, it could be. I mean, I think it's a good discussion to have.
Mm-hmm.
So using that example, though, I think there's more of a mix of architectural style and period once you move away from the core Main Street. So there were a couple of mill buildings in that area,
mm-hmm.
that were much simpler.
Mm-hmm.
So which buildings do you refer to?
Mm-hmm.
And I guess that's why it comes to the board, because you guys can make that decision. But I don't know if this would hold you to assuming one style over the other, one historic character over another.
Well, I guess I think that the whole point of the guidelines is that if we're creating new buildings within the district, we want them to be theme buildings. Is that true?
Right, but that point has surrounding and historic buildings, and you implied that surrounding means the whole district.
Right.
I wouldn't interpret it that way if I was reading this.
Yeah, I think surrounding is a smaller
right.
locality.
Mm-hmm.
And then in which
immediately
case...
Immediately adjacent to them.
And actually, it kind of adds ambiguity to the whole thing, which lets us make our judgment call.
I guess the only fear is that in a location where there aren't buildings that are particularly significant and someone wants to put up a new building, then do they have free rein to put up something that doesn't really...
I would say not, but I would say they have more flexibility than if it was closer to the center of town.
Mm-hmm.
Like, is Green Street not a district? Green and West Street?
Yeah.
It's a sub-district now, isn't it?
Yes, I think it goes up to that intersection now.
Because I'm just saying, you know, that there, those are all relatively low height buildings that have, there's almost no masonry row buildings like that all in that area,
mm-hmm.
so.
Oh, right, well, you guys just reviewed that, the corner building.
Right.
There,
which
so.
Is actually, it's sort of bar, if you notice, they haven't so often covered. They took that.
Yeah,
off,
yeah.
But you know what I'm saying, you wouldn't build a building like that bus station building up on Green Street or West Street.
You could. What's there replaced a building like the bus station? That was a hotel. It's like
I know, the old hotel. Yeah, it's beautiful. Yeah.
So we would, and we could want to have somebody build something like that up there.
Mm-hmm.
But there aren't any surrounding buildings to work off of necessarily. I suppose there's the Smith College buildings and the library, but.
Parking garage.
Yeah, like Joseph, I think by leaving the term surrounding leaves enough ambiguity that we can, it opens a discussion for us.
Yeah, you could have someone argue why or why not they're using a certain style facade detailing that's.
Since we're such an open-minded committee, I'm sure we can listen to that.
I think it makes sense for us to have more flexibility the farther away from the main intersection, or from the farther away from Main Street we are.
I think you have to let a 21st century architect present his or her ideas on a project. And that's the purpose of guidelines. These are not restrictions, these are guidelines to bring them into discussion with us. And if they can justify their design, you know, who are we to say that's bad design?
That's our job. We've been appointed.
Well, no, but our job is to say whether we think they're meeting the intent of the guidelines.
And then I was thinking, we say what you were just saying within the Central Business Architecture Committee's
district.
Jurisdiction district, exactly. Something like per the CBAC committee's discretion, something like that.
We don't, somebody could bring us a project that had nothing to do with the guidelines and we could approve it if we thought it was appropriate. Because the guidelines are there because if somebody wants to be sure that they're going to get approved, then they can do something like that. If somebody presented us with another Silverscape building, my guess is we would say yes, even though the Silverscape building breaks every guideline we have.
Sort of like, what if Frank Gehry walks in the door with you? I'm going to chase him
out. Boy.
Maybe.
Somebody will put Marlin to work downtown.
And I don't think we don't want to say, and the intent of this ordinance was not to say, you can't do anything that doesn't conform to the guidelines. The intent of the ordinance was to preserve the downtown Northampton is an architecturally interesting place, and we could approve a building that, like the Silverscape building, if we wanted to. But
you mean the bank building,
yeah,
the former bank building,
right?
Yeah.
I don't think that conforms to any guidelines that we have, except for the height of the building.
The windows have rhythm to them.
Pardon?
The facade. You can find something, don't you think?
Well, I would think that would be considered a landmark building.
It would. If somebody wanted
to
tear down CVS
building.
And put a landmark building there,
I would approve it.
It wouldn't have to be. I don't think it would have to be another theme building that matched what's next door to it. Although, I would, I would probably look at anything other than that with a skeptical eye, but I wouldn't rule it out.
Mm-hmm.
But that's why I say, it's good that we have, the farther away from Main Street, the more flexible we should be.
And do you have a strong feeling that should be changed, that middle point?
No, I didn't bring it up. Carolyn brought it up.
No, I don't have a strong feeling. I'm not on the committee, but I just brought it up because there was a discussion about
which is ambiguous.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's fine. I just wanted to make sure you sort of hashed that through, since there have been examples of occasions when you had to look at that.
I think we should leave it. I think we should leave it.
Trademark building details, conspicuous signature architectural elements other than signs, which are unique to a particular franchise business, are not consistent with the historic character of downtown Northampton.
No. of golden arches?
Evidently not.
That's also kind of, to me, some, it's not really a guideline, it's sort of a statement, I guess.
It's guiding you away from.
It is a guideline. It's telling you, it's telling you what you can't do.
Yeah, right.
It's a restriction.
Yeah. I have no trouble with that, yeah.
Okay.
What other, are there other examples? I can't, my brain is frozen. I can't think of other examples of our trademark building details. Are they even used anymore?
White hut, hamburger.
Yeah, like a White Castle.
White Castle, yeah.
I mean, it's kind of signage, but like the.
The building represents the.
Like Best Buy ran into a little heat, I think it was at time over in Hadley. You know, the Best Buy has that big blue like thing.
Wedge.
That sticks off their building, they didn't want it there.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know.
And that's not considered a sign.
But it's kind of signage, yeah, but it's also built into the architecture, right?
Okay. Maybe it's a fade, a fad that's faded.
Right. But yeah, besides like the White Castle, the White Huts, I can't think of any real signature, you know, commercial signature looking buildings, right?
I feel like rest stops and things like that sometimes have, but I guess they're the Golden Arches usually.
Actually, the little old White Castle restaurants are considered landmarks.
Are they?
Oh, absolutely. You can run into a group, I think it's the Society for Commercial Archaeology. Uh-huh. And they're into storefronts and franchise buildings and strip malls and all that. Products of their time.
Good for that.
Anyway.
All right, guideline 13, mechanical equipment. For historic buildings, fire escapes, window-mounted air conditioners, or other mechanical features should not be installed in ways which irreversibly damage historic features or materials. On masonry buildings, mounting hardware should be attached to mortar joints rather than to the masonry itself. That seems fine.
Yeah.
Rooftop mechanical equipment should not be visible from street views. That's fine too. Where feasible, fire escapes, window-mounted air conditioners, or other mechanical features should not be located on facades which front major streets. I agree. I think it's funny
should
that
be anywhere in the city.
But it shouldn't be anywhere in the city. Well, it is interesting, you know, this example, which is, you know, in the parking lot behind Starbucks. It is such a an architectural feature, or you know, something that we see so frequently. It's not very beautiful, but it's. I see it all the time, but there's no way, it's the back of the building, there's no way to avoid that.
Yeah, that whole.
I have a question on this particular photograph. The wood structure, is that code?
I don't think any of those fire escapes meet current code.
Yeah. But if you wanted to put a new one up there and have it considered a fire escape, you couldn't do it out of wood, could you?
You could do it out of wood as long as you provide sprinklers. You'd have to have a dry system.
On the exterior?
Yeah, it would be a dry system sprinkler.
Anyway, I don't like the wood stuff. It just looks too suburban ranch house decky looking.
Yeah.
I think that's very inappropriate.
Looks horrible.
You know, it's sometimes when you go back to some of those, you know, behind the scenes areas where you have all those attached things, it's interesting what you notice, even though you go by there all the time. I think it wasn't that long ago that I noticed there's that old sign on that lower first level. It was kind of, it's right at the bottom of that one photograph. I was going to see if I could get it here. But I think it's a shoe store
David's
or something.
Boots.
Was that what it was?
Mm-hmm.
It's
and that
still
business
there.
Hasn't been there for 50 years.
Isn't that funny how that?
That's in that from the Masonic Street lot.
It's in the right. The
those lower
lot, right?
Yeah. Well, all those, that build out in the bottom was like a land grab or something.
Yeah, it's like this,
see
at the bottom of the
buildings?
Photo,
yeah.
That corrugated metal trailer. There's a sign right there, like right below the photo for that. Anyway.
Well, I don't know if we can say anything about, about fire escapes, you know, being metal or,
Well, the only thing we have purview over is what's visible from public street, right?
Well, this is pretty visible from public street.
Right, but I would guess that went on way before.
Right. But I guess if somebody came before us to, like, if they have to repair or replace that.
Well, that's come before, so even, like, on the side where the Greenfield Savings Bank is going, that fire escape came before you guys,
right.
And that's steel.
Right.
And then that one behind Main Street, but it faces Harold's. Remember how the property owner did the whole back?
Oh, right.
You guys looked at that staircase too, or that fire escape as well. So, yeah, I mean, I think you've been pretty consistent about not, you know, metal versus.
Well, like you said, who would build a wood fire escape and then have to deal with the sprinkler?
Ed Gall, that's the answer to that question. You remember Ed Gall?
Oh, yeah.
He would build wood fire escape.
Yeah, but then when he found out what it would cost to install a sprinkler system,
when he did that, you didn't have to do the sprinkler.
Well, yeah, I know that, yeah.
Well, I think where I see what I consider as kind of bad examples are not fire escapes, but handicap accessibility ramps on the front of some of the buildings, particularly on King Street. Beyond the hotel, there are a couple of houses that have been fixed up with just overwhelmingly large accessibility ramps coming in that just look like unfinished wood, you know, pressure treated or something. And they look like somebody's backyard deck as opposed to an addition to a building. And again, I don't know that we're not dealing with accessibility stuff in this paragraph, but you know, that's what I'm thinking of when I look at that. You know, that to me is inappropriate, and we probably would not approve that.
There are many conflicts between accessibility and historic preservation.
Yeah, that's huge. Mm-hmm. That's the trickiest part of rehab, I think.
There's no way to make that building accessible from the front without ruining whatever historic value the building.
Yeah, but I think choice of materials, colors, and all that.
Well, is this a place you want to consider adding language that, let me just see, actually it might be in there, it might not be exempt.
Don't they have inspections on building that has to do with structural inspections on the fire escapes?
Maybe it's the fire, I don't know.
I think it's the building department. I was going to say
at one point, you know, that wooden structure won't probably pass,
right. You
know, anymore. Mm-hmm. And then the requirements would be to replace. And then I don't think it could pass, well, that particular looking structure would never pass, just in terms of, just in terms of the way it was built structurally and engineered. I think the engineering of fire escapes is a lot more now, isn't it? Technically, I mean, there's a lot more.
Yeah, there's the fire escape. It's very, very nice on Cracker Barrel Alley. And I wonder if... I wonder if whose jurisdiction that fell under.
We looked at that.
Oh, really? Cool.
Yeah,
that whole little corner in there.
Yeah, that's very nice. So however you got that moved forward, maybe...
Well, I think that was a Tom Douglas project, and I think he knows what we would expect. I wonder if we could say something like fire escapes that are visible shall be made out of materials that are compatible,
or you could just say, it also depends, I guess. So there's some on King Street, I was going to say shall not be wood, but on King Street, the financial services building that got completely renovated, and they really designed the ramp so they're sort of hidden, and then the other building a block down that still looks unfinished.
Right. Yeah.
But well, they were supposed to do the same thing, but I think partially the problem is that it's unfinished. That's supposed to be painted. I assume it looks terrible. But I think those are wood, but then you go to the Melnick law offices, and that wasn't done in the same way. So I don't know if...
I think the financial services, I can't think of the name of the company.
Gage Wiley.
Their building was a lot wider than Melnick's building, so it gave them a lot more latitude to make it look nice, whereas Melnick's building is pretty narrow, it's pretty small. So there was probably no way to make that look good.
Well, I think the Elm Street guidelines address that issue without being that specific. And they talk about such devices should be designed to avoid obscuring or damaging historical features and to allow historical features to be readily restored if the device is removed. And it basically talks, the commission will work with the property owner to find a solution that incorporates the desired goals of both accessibility and preservation. So there might be some good words in this.
Mm-hmm.
Page 14 of the Elm Street guidelines, if you wanted to peek at that. And again, that's dealing with a historic district as opposed to central business district.
Do we have, do we have any leverage over the demands of accessibility?
No.
That's pretty much dictated by code.
Yes, right.
But you can review over the design.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I think that we can say that the design of, you know, this is particularly about ramps, but we could also say fire escapes. Such elements should be designed to, to avoid obscuring or damaging historical features on the building and to allow those features to be restored.
Well, could we say it's impossible to design something that won't damage the historic feature of the building and therefore that they don't have to make it handicap accessible?
No, you can't. We don't have that jurisdiction. There's always ways to make it accessible.
Well, what's the concern here? Is the transparency or...
Tart Bakery, there's no way to make that handicap accessible. Not if it's reasonable.
Right, so then they would go... That was in our jurisdiction.
Right.
They would need to get
a waiver
from the state for that.
Well, but even so, they're right on the property line. So, unless they built a ramp into the...
Well, that's why I say there's no way to make that accessible.
Right, and so then they have to go through the whole variance process with the state and say this is why they can't do it.
I think when you're designing something like that, instead of selecting pressure-treated wood to build it, you can talk about pipe rails painted black or something that is less visually intrusive but just as functional and as acceptable to meet code.
Right.
Because, it already mentions about, mortar joints and not just, things being fastened correctly, but what are we trying to get at? We don't want clunky wooden structures that obscure the visibility. So
yeah,
we could learn something like that.
No clunky wooden
structures. Well,
do you think it would?
Yeah, no, that's.
I'm trying to. So you can word it like, to use lightweight visual materials that would not impede the view of the structure.
You could say materials should be used. So to minimize the visual impact of the structure.
And I think that gives us opportunity to not negotiate, but sort of to work with.
So that's a new bullet point then, correct?
Yeah, unless there's something else in here about accessibility.
So I guess this is.
It's not just handicap. It's not just accessibility. It'd be for fire escape too.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right.
Interestingly, this guideline is under mechanical equipment, and for some reason they've thrown in fire escapes here, which isn't really a mechanical feature.
Well, maybe it should be, maybe we should change the guideline title to
mechanical accessibility and...
Well, I guess access.
The word is egress.
Yeah.
Egress and accessibility.
Egress elements.
Structures or, yeah.
Egress elements and accessibility elements, which would, or egress and accessibility elements, which would incorporate the fire escape and ramps. So you could say that fire escapes and ramps shall be built.
We can just say, you could use the same thing. Materials used for egress or accessibility should be made to minimize, should be chosen to minimize the visual impact, the visual impact on the structure.
Yeah, there you go.
I would say egress or accessibility elements.
You need a noun there.
Elements, right?
Or you could call them structures.
You could call it, so I like
structures.
Materials
in the
used for that. Egress or accessibility structures should be.
Yeah, structures.
And then structures, the end, right, impact on the building.
Components or structures?
Structures.
Materials for egress or accessibility structures should minimize their visual impact on the
building.
Actually,
I would say
building.
Magic.
Okay. Next one. Guideline 14. Drive-through commercial services. Standalone drive-through commercial services are incompatible with the historic character, pedestrian activity, and restricted traffic patterns of the downtown district, and should therefore not be located so as to be visible or accessible from downtown streets. No issue with that.
No problem with that. No. Okay, I have no problem with that.
If access can be provided for a drive-through by means other than a downtown street, then a standalone drive-through may be located in the district, but should only be located so as not to be visible from downtown streets. Again, that seems fine.
I have a question about that.
Mm-hmm.
So that could also be a bank. So is it the drive-through component that shouldn't be visible from downtown streets?
Right.
Okay. Okay. I'm just thinking about, so there's the bank, or is it TD North has that drive-through from Center Street, which is sort of that back alley parking lot area. And then I'm just sort of thinking about the Pleasant Street corridor.
There is one on King Street, like next down from Silverscape. That's the records building.
Right.
That's not there
with a drive through, I think, in the back, is that?
Oh,
there's drive through.
Is it People's
but
Bank right next to A to Z?
It's not freestanding, just drive through. Like,
so standalone.
So, Chance, we wouldn't approve that TD Bank thing today, probably, off of Center Street.
But it is part of the bank, is that that's the back part of the bank. So I think it's probably the same thing as the People's Bank. Issue. You actually have the bank, but there's a drive-through window, as opposed to the bank-in-the-box thing, you know, standalone drive-up ATM.
It's not a separate structure off of Center Street in that parking lot?
No. It's attached to the building.
Right, the one that's right next to A to Z, is that what you're talking about?
No,
the one behind, across from the police station.
Back
oh, right.
Yeah, so.
Interesting.
Okay. I mean, I think this is fine. I think I just wanted to make sure that.
I mean, today, let's say the one, the TD Bank behind the lot, behind Faces there and all that.
Yeah.
Now, the way that reads, would that be allowed today? I mean, because the parking lot Is that a view from a public street? I don't know.
Is it
not? We have that situation where it comes up a lot, like the Masonic Street Lodge. Can you call that visible or not from the public street? You know?
Well, it's visible, but it is true. You could also fill this parking lot with a building.
And if you filled it with a building, then
you
would not
see that.
Yeah.
I'm kind of so pissed off about Peter's building on Masonic Street there. I just, you look at the back of that building and it just looks incomplete. It kind of really bothers me.
But from the back, not from the street.
Yeah, but it's visible. I mean, you know, you go down Center Street, you can see the back of the building, you know, and it just was so cut off. But
what's that? That got shifted around.
It's a site average.
Yeah.
Anyway. Well, in any case, so
I think both of those would probably still work because they're not standalone.
Yeah.
I just wanted to make sure I wrap my head around that. Understood.
There's too many locations left in this town where they could even put one of those things. Further down Pleasant Street, possibly.
Okay, next.
Yeah.
Guideline 15, signs located above the first floor. Historic sign fascia bands above first floor storefronts should be preserved when present. Northampton zoning ordinance provides regulations on sign quantity, size, and placement. Those regulations normally limit signs in the central business district to one main wall or awning sign per facade per establishment. These regulations are compatible with the downtown district character. New business signs, I'm sorry, are we okay with those things that I've said? Okay. New business signs should normally be placed in the flat fascia band above the first floor glazing or should be contained within a fabric, not rigid awning. Signs should not be placed so as to obscure special historic features or detailing. Again, I'm fine with all of that. Signs should be mounted so as to avoid irreversibly damaging historic building features or materials. Mounting hardware for masonry buildings should be attached to mortar joints rather than to the masonry itself. So I guess my only question about this is we don't really have jurisdiction over the signs itself. That's really part of Northampton zoning ordinance, right?
Yeah.
So.
But we do if it obscures any special features of the building.
But I mean, a lot of the buildings that come to us, we don't even necessarily see what the signage is going to be. That often comes later.
Well, and it could be just that the project never comes to you anyway because it's just a sign replacement. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, new business signs, like you bring a new business in our building, it doesn't even come to us.
Right, and so as I'm reading this too, I'm thinking, you know, no one's out there checking to make sure they're putting the sign in the mortar joints and not the...
Right.
I mean, even if they say they're going to do that, which I can't think of there have been maybe a couple of occasions where there's more of a structural sign that's being put in, you know, more of a, not a panel sign or something.
Mm-hmm.
And we've specifically called out that it can't, you know, we've looked at how they're mounting it to make sure it's not going to.
Mm-hmm.
But the follow-up, I mean, who knows if the installer is really going to care about that. They're just going to put it in where they can, right? So, I mean, nobody's checking on that, I guess is what
right.
I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's still worth having in here so that people know what's expected
right.
of them.
Yeah.
And chances are people will look at that and say, okay, it's not a big deal.
Right.
Okay. To conform to it.
I mean,
actually,
if it requires some, sorry.
Oh, well, I'm sorry, I was gonna say, I actually read about signs in this CD district application. And I did, in fact, go back to see where they put the sign because it does say at the beginning, is there a sign proposed or something like that? There is some language in there, and the architect filled it out by saying no or yes. And an example is where Theory is on Main Street.
Which one?
Theory, the
skateboard.
Yeah, where Western So I think it, asks on our application if there's a signage on the backside, or if it says, is there existing signage?
Yeah.
And so maybe we can correlate that with, you know, just review the application again to see what that language is.
I mean, if someone still want to put up a sign and it was fairly substantial in terms of weight or structure, would that go before the building department?
Well, any sign does. Every sign is supposed to.
Not just, okay.
Not even the sign panel replacement. So technically, you know, when you put up, when a business changes hands and the new sign goes in, they're supposed to file for a sign permit for the building department. And usually they do.
Yeah, so I would hope that the building department, upon reviewing that plan, would see the mounting techniques.
Yeah.
And have to say to whoever wanted to do that, you know, that you can't fasten them to destroy part of the original, you know, masonry.
I have to check with the building department, but I would think as well that there's a safety issue too, wanting to understand how it's being mounted, so that they would be checking that anyway. Whereas a lot of them are just panel replacements, so you're swapping one with the other, or repainting or something, and that's pretty straightforward. Yeah. But I think you're right, with there's a new structural mount or something, that they would be checking that anyway to make sure that it's secured safely.
One of the things that seems to be a conflict here, potentially, I don't know, but it says that the if there is an awning, it should be fabric and not rigid. Mm-hmm. But I think that there are many awnings on Main Street that are rigid.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, it's semantic. What does rigid imply? I mean, to me,
plastic.
or a metal structure. I was thinking of metal, possibly a metal structure, uh-huh, or plastic. But the kind of signs that are really stretched tight over a metal frame.
Yeah.
You don't consider that rigid, right?
No, that would be fabric.
That's still fabric.
Yeah.
Right.
But I think that there are some out there that are not fabric.
Right.
Yeah. Well, like that purple falafel.
Yes,
thing.
Exactly.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah.
How did that get passed?
It didn't go for a permit.
Oh, really?
Oh, wow. Or should be contained in a moving bag within a fabric. It should be. Yeah, so I don't know if you wanna, if that makes a difference, if that guideline. I mean, so I guess there are two things. One is, if the applicant's coming forward for a whole building project, you can look at the package, but again, at that time, they might not know who the tenants are, and they might not know what the signage is.
Right.
Sometimes they do. They have a plan, you know, a whole schematic for where the signs are going to go to match the architecture, but of the building. But so at that time, you could weigh in. Otherwise, I don't know if this language. I mean, I suppose it's a good guidance, but there's no teeth really in it, so I don't know if it makes sense to keep or if you still want to.
I think it makes sense to keep just for the guidance aspect of it.
Mm. So if they do come before us with signage, we can talk about what the intent is.
Yeah, what might be appropriate given the location of the.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just a step back, I was just thinking of something. Under the mechanical equipment we were talking about, it says refusable fire escapes, window mounted air conditioners or other mechanical features should not be located on facades which front major streets. But there's no restrictions on people just putting window air conditioners in their windows on Main Street.
Right.
Which is ugly, we know, but so
how did that?
There's no enforcement.
But there's also a reversible change.
Well, they're not permanent. But a window mounted air conditioner isn't permanent, but we have it in the guidelines.
Yeah.
I'm just pointing it out. I mean, there's no way to enforce it.
It says, they should not be installed in ways which irreversibly prevent it. So that's what's important.
Right, yeah, I mean, you wouldn't cut all through the masonry wall and put a...
So that needs to be there, yeah. Even if people are allowed to put window air conditioners in, just if they do, it has to be a temporary installation.
Every time you walk down Main Street and see the little piddles from the tubes, right, people drop the little plastic tubes down to about the first floor.
If they bother, yeah.
Just going back to guideline 15 for a minute, the first point talks about historic sign bands above first floor storefronts should be preserved when present, which implies that we're talking about an existing building, but nowhere do we talk about new buildings being required to have a sign band incorporated into the facade above a storefront. And should that...
In the third bullet, it talks about placing the flat fascia band above first floor.
So do we somewhere say that there should be a sign band incorporated into theme buildings?
Didn't we talk about that?
It indicates where it's located as opposed to a specific structural frame or something like that. That's pretty...
First floor facades, maybe?
Oh, you added that.
Oh, I did, on first floor facades.
On first floor facades, guideline 7, as a final bullet, sign bands of appropriate proportions are encouraged.
Okay. Already covered.
Write it yourself.
So that's it for guidelines, if we're all in agreement. Good job, everybody.
Now we just fixed it.
Now we need to review the draft, probably.
Right.
And confirm that we're all in agreement with that. The last part of the guidelines is appendices, which I haven't had a chance to read yet. I guess it's more of a reference, but I guess we should probably read it. The first appendices is downtown Northampton, character defining features. I'm almost inclined, because I would actually like to read this and then come back and talk about it.
It's a lot.
Yes, it is. Yeah. If that's okay. If
we, yeah.
This thing's online, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I don't know what happened to my...
I sent it in the last email for this meeting, right? The latest edited version, so you can use that, too.
So the appendices are in that?
Yeah.
Okay, mm-hmm. I can read it there.
So I won't have a draft, a revision, for the next meeting, but we can work on this. And I'm having an intern start to help me with collecting photos and stuff like that for the beginning part. Maybe for the subsequent meeting.
For the next meeting, we want to review the appendices.
Yeah, so if it's okay with you, just to do the appendices and not worry about looking at the draft for the next meeting.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's fine. So, are there any other further comments on what we've discussed so far tonight?
I would say on number 2, the Secretary of the Interior Standards, this is the updated 1990 version. There might be a more recent version. I haven't looked at them in a long time, and I doubt that they're changed that much, but certainly wouldn't hurt to look up to the latest.
Well, wait till you see how they change it.
I think there was an executive order getting rid of all of them.
That's with the Department of the Interior.
And that's probably true for Mass General Law Chapter 40C standards, whether that's up to date or not.
Allison's fathers helped write the original ones back in 66.
But maybe that's something we can do. That's our homework, is to find out those things.
Something to do.
Any further comments about what we've discussed tonight?
We were commenting on the little cornice on the commercial building on Green Street that they're replacing with copper. It really looks good.
Okay.
A lot of detail on it, so it's a nice looking job. It'll be prettier when it turns green, but the form is nice.
Okay. That was an example of us pushing back a little bit to get a little more detail. Anything else for tonight? Can I get a motion to
So moved.
A second? All in favor?
Yeah, okay. Turn off the machine.